How precious is your steadfast love, O God. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light. Welcome to the online version of our worship this Sunday. As I mentioned on Wednesday, we are going to now start having outdoor worship every week. But if you're worshiping at home, keep on going. I'm glad to have you, and we're all joined together in the body of Christ. If you're outdoors or online, consider coming to our Google Meet Sundays at 6:30. And for a few more weeks, probably one more week, we'll keep accepting school supplies for Alexander Wilson, and get in touch with me if you'd like to contribute. Today, I'm going to begin talking about Exodus. We're going to be in Exodus for at least the next several weeks, and I'm going to talk about trying to center God's activity, making God the subject of our verbs, because it's God who's activating the universe right now and has blessed us all with life. And so, I want to pray today a Charles Wesley hymn. It is called All Praise to Our Redeeming Lord. And here are the ways in which not only does it give praise to Christ and to God, but centers anything we can do in the life of God. Would you pray with me? All praise to our redeeming Lord, who joins us by his grace and bids us each to each restored together seek his face. He bids us build each other up, and gathered into one, to our high calling's glorious hope, we hand in hand go on. The gift which he on one bestows, we all delight to prove. The grace through every vessel flows in purest streams of love. Almighty God, act in this world. Act through us if you will. But just act, Lord. Help us to see your action and to center you in our lives and center us in the world through your grace. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. The text I will be reading from is the beginning of Exodus. And listen here for how God is at work, the way the text says and the way it might become obvious that God is at work. This is from Exodus chapter 1, verse 8 through chapter 2, verse 10. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him. But if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, God gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside it. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take the child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because she said, "I drew him out of the water." I wasn't gonna sing another song, but it just came to me this morning, so I'm going to. I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more at night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man I wandered along. Worries and fears I claim for my own. Then like the blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more at night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray, for straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more at night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. So that song came to me because I think it's extraordinarily theologically dense. And what struck me in this song is that when God acts in the song, eyes are opened, lives change. And when the narrator acts, things don't go so well. Whenever the singer of the song, Hank Williams or whoever, says an I, things end up bad. I wandered. I wouldn't let Jesus in. Now, I saw the light, but the song makes it clear that it is God. Jesus comes like a stranger in the night. The narrator wanders alone until God acts. And I've become increasingly aware of a tendency I have when I preach, and certainly when I hear other sermons, or even when we talk as Christians. And that is the tendency to should. When I'm not sure exactly how to conclude, the easiest thing to do is to say, because of this interpretation, this brilliant interpretation I've made of the text, we should love our neighbor. We should pray a different way. We should live this way. The tendency is always to conclude with what we should do. And when you become aware of this tendency to sort of should people, we do it all the time. When we have a meeting, what should we do? How should Christians act? We should love our neighbor. We should start this. We should do this. We should go on a mission trip here. And if you pay attention in our world, all the time we say Christians should act this way, or Christians shouldn't act that way. Christians should vote this way, or they shouldn't vote that way. And you're not a Christian if you don't do the things you should do. Right? We should people until we've split up the world. Now look, there are certainly things we should do. But if all we talk about is what we should do, eventually it becomes just about us, about our own activity, and that is wandering. So, as I start talking about Exodus, my goal is to not should us. My goal is to make God the subject of my verbs. Because God is acting a lot in Exodus. You're probably ready. God's gonna do some plagues, gonna give some commands. God's gonna part the sea. God's gonna do a lot. And God, what God is doing, should be at the center of our lives with a few shoulds on the outside. And very often it seems to me that what we should do is the center, and God's guidance is kind of used when we like it. So I want to center God. I want to make God the subject of verbs and talk about what God does. And I want to give one example that we will come back to in a few weeks. There are commands in Exodus. There are commandments, in fact. And so it is easy to take the Ten Commandments and to say, don't you murder. Don't you steal? Don't you have idols? But if we make God the subject of our verbs, the commandments might look a little different. This is an interpretation I'm stealing from Wesley and some other people. But what if we treat the commandments more than just commands of what we should do? What if the commandments are promises of God? Don't murder. If we make God the subject, is instead, I am making a world where you will not murder, where people will not be killed, and people won't be harmed by the evil it does to a soul to have to kill someone. I am making a world where murder will not happen. I am making a world where theft will not be necessary, where theft will not occur. Not just, don't you steal now, but God promises in the commandments a world where everyone will have enough, where people won't be moved to thieve to feed themselves. The commandments are a promise of God, and the biggest promise is someday you will not worship idols. When we center God's activity, it becomes less about shaming the people who don't follow the rules. And so, when we consider this text, we know God's going to do a lot in Exodus, but there's sort of an inauspicious beginning to the text. God is not the subject of very many verbs in this beginning. In fact, just about the only one I could find is God dealt well with the midwives. What God is doing in this text is underwriting, supporting, and blessing civil disobedience. The midwives are resisting an unjust law. And God is dealing well with them. God gives them families. God supports them and gives them that inspiration to be kind of crafty when Pharaoh comes to them. And in fact, even before we hear about the midwives, we're told that the Israelite people flourish. They no matter how much they're oppressed, no matter how much control Pharaoh tries to have, they're multiplying. They're doing well. They're having a lot of children. They're becoming powerful because they're blessed by God. God is supporting people who are oppressed and preparing to liberate them. Even when it looks like Pharaoh has all the power, God is the one who's really in control in the text. God is reminding us here that the way the world is isn't necessarily because God has blessed it. God didn't put Pharaoh there. God's working for those who are resisting Pharaoh. Just because our world works a certain way, just because the powers that be, whoever they might be, Pharaoh or a king, are in power, does not mean that God put them there. And in fact, God tends to be working for the people that king is exactly most afraid of. God is working behind the scenes to undo evil. And we can't always look at the world and see it. Because the next thing God does here is set up this whole Moses situation. And think about how incredible it is that Pharaoh has given the order that a child be drowned in the Nile, and Moses ends up in the Nile and uses it eventually to liberate the people. God, I was talking about resurrection last week. This is resurrection. God is using the evil order of Pharaoh to eventually liberate the people. God isn't mentioned in the story of Moses, but it is clear that God is at work in these small events that will lead to the Israelites crossing the Red Sea. God is working in this world, sometimes in imperceivable ways, to make the world right, to free the oppressed. And so, imagine for a moment you are an Israelite in Egypt. All you might know is that this Pharaoh is getting worse and worse. He's making you work harder than you have. He has enslaved your people. And you might know that some children are getting through, but mainly you know that some children are getting killed. And at this point, unless you are one of Moses' family members, you do not know that there is a child being raised in Pharaoh's household who is an Israelite. All you would know if you were an Israelite is that things seem to be getting worse. And later in the text, they're going to cry out. And imagine for a moment that you are an Egyptian. I guarantee you those Egyptians, if they heard about Pharaoh making this order, kill the children, they said, well, good. We don't need any more of these Israelites around here. And they certainly have not heard of Moses. An Egyptian would not have any clue what God was about to do. God is making a way in our world. And sometimes that works in ways that are impossible for us to perceive. It may be today that we're Israelites, longing to be freed from the evil in the world. And it may be that we're Egyptians, benefiting from evil. And we don't even know it. But God is making a way. God is working even in the darkness of this world. That's ultimately good news. I wonder what God's going to do with this world, with this darkness. But I'm certain it's happening now. Would you pray with me? God of resurrection, make a way through the darkness. Heal our lives and heal our hearts that we may be part of your plan to redeem this world. Act, Lord. Save us. And Lord, we pray for all those who are sick, all those who we have been praying for, who need prayer, and those who have no one praying for them. Make a way in this world for them as well, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace and know that God is at work. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.